SELinux stands for Security Enhanced Linux and was originally developed by the United States National Security Agency, and in 2000 it was released in the open source community. Now, before we can see what the advantages of SELinux are, we have to first do a quick recap of how Linux system security works without SELinux. So with traditional security, whenever a program gets started, and this may be a user shell when a user logs in, for example, or a daemon that runs a particular application, like, for example, a web server, the process that runs the application will always get a user ID and a group ID connected to it. That process is referred to as a subject, and the subject wants to perform an action on an object, which may be a regular file, a directory, or a device file, or some other file type. The only way to protect these objects is by setting permissions on the objects. So in short, this means that every object has an owner in the form of a user ID and a group ID and three sets of permissions, read, write and execute for the user, the group and the rest of the world. So this access of objects is regulated by a combination of IDs and permissions. And what's very important, the owner determines object access privileges. This technique is called DAC, or discretionary access control. So access is determined at the discretion of the user. In other words, it's all about IDs. Now, why is that not secure enough? So imagine you've got a running web server with user ID 48, and imagine this process gets compromised by people with malicious intent. Then these attackers will be able to access all files that user ID 48 can access, and potentially do a lot of harm to your system. So, for example, since most configuration files are world-readable, this process is able to read the contents of your etc host file, which will give away all IP addresses stored in there, or the etc password with all usernames and many other files on your system. And exactly this is where SELinux can help. Now, how can SELinux help? SELinux brings an additional layer of security, so it is not a replacement of the traditional security method based upon IDs and permissions. It is an addition to that. After the traditional permissions have been checked, SELinux will step in and perform an additional check. Now, how does that work? All subjects will have a label, and when you create new files in your system, these will also be labeled if SELinux is active. And simply put, a subject is only able to access an object if the labels match. Conceptually, we could look at it like this. Imagine a process gets label A, and on disk there are files that also have label A. Another process gets a different label, and there will be files on disk that will match that particular label. Now, if the process that has label A tries to access a file that also has label A, the permission will be granted by SELinux. Of course, first traditional access will be checked, so SELinux does not have to step in if the user ID has no read, write or execute permission, because, as stated, the order is first discretionary access control and then SELinux. If the same process with label A tries to access a file that has label B, permission will be denied, irrespective of the user ID. So even if the user ID is zero, or in other words, the root user, permission can be denied by SELinux. This is referred to as mandatory access control, because the operating system itself will step in. So the traditional security mechanism of discretionary access control is complemented by mandatory access control. Now, what about these labels? A label contains the context type, and labels with the same context type belong to the same domain. Now, the domain can be regarded as a container or a sandbox kind of thing. It simply means that, by default, context types cannot break out of their domains. So basically, as discussed, a subject with a particular context type cannot access an object that has a different context type. Now, this is all based upon policies and rules in policies, which are managed by a Linux security module, which has hooks into the kernel. Now, please check out this page for some more information. Now let's get back to these context types. So, for example, the password binary has the context type password in its label and is of the password underscore exec type. And so, if you run the password command, that process is not allowed to touch the /etc/httpd file because it has a different context type and it is in a different domain. Now let's see what this looks like in real life. What we'll do is we'll have a look at these labels that are connected to objects and to subjects, and we'll make a change to our web server that will leave us with a dysfunctional web server. We'll focus on the capital Z option for the ls, ps and ls off command to disclose the labels of files, processes and ports. And we will use SELinux to find out why our web server isn't functioning anymore. So I'm logged in as root, and first I want to know where I can find the httpd binary. And then I run the ls-l-z option to look into this label. So there's quite some information in this label, but what I'm interested in is this httpd underscore exec underscore t, which is the context type. The other information we'll deal with later. Now I run the same command, but now for the httpd configuration file. And again, we see that it's httpd underscore config underscore t, which means that it belongs to the same domain. So basically this goes for all files that have to do with httpd, like the log files, for example. They also belong to this domain. Now let's find out whether our web server is running and what port it's using. That will give us quite some output, so we just filter on whether it's active and what the port would be. And we see it's up and running and it's listening to port 80. And when we check the running processes, we see that the context type of all of these daemons is httpd underscore t, as we expected. And when we use list open files to check our ports and filter on httpd, we see that httpd is listening on port 80. And again, the context type is what we expected. Now let's change the port to which our web server listens, so to which it will have to connect in order to be able to listen. So we check the configuration file, and we could change that using an editor, but I'm going to use SED, and I will change the port from 80 to 8888. And then we'll see what happens when we restart our web server. So we've changed the port, and we're going to run systemctl restart httpd. And we get an error message. Now we could have a look at this journal CTL or simply run systemctl status. And to avoid too much output, we simply grep on the interesting fields like whether it's active and running or not, and whether it's listening and to what port. And also I want to see whether port 8888 comes up in this output. So it tells us that it failed to start and there was a permission denied to create a socket because it could not bind to port 8888 and no listening sockets are available, so it's shutting down again. Now this information is all from the perspective of the web server, but SELinux has blocked it. So let's take a look at the SELinux log output, why it has blocked it. So there's a command which is called SELinux, and we'll look at that a little bit more later on, but that will give us some information from the perspective of SELinux. So it not only tells us that it has prevented the web server from connecting to that port, but it also advises us to run the SEManage command to add this port to the equation so that the web server will be able to connect to port 8888. And in this last line, we can very nicely see that the web server's context type does not match the context type of that port because that's of the unreserved port type. Now let's re-establish the original situation by changing the port from 8888 to 80 again in the configuration file of httpd. And after we did that, we can try and restart the service. And now the service will be up and running again, so our web server is fine. And in the next module, we'll have a look at the states SELinux can be in and what modes there are, as well as the possibility of types. So basically, this is on how you could configure it. And we will see that most packages are installed by default, but some are not.